everybody, and welcome back again to another episode of Dragon Age Inquisition. Today I want to head out into the Western Approach again to finish some of the quests there, but mainly because I want to do a recap of the game so far. I have been asked quite a while ago if I would be interested in doing something like that, and I think this is maybe a good time to do so, to do some sort of, I don't know if it's actually a half-time recap, because I don't know how much time and how much more content this game actually has. But I mean, we have a bit to talk about, and I want to do this while I finish some of the collection quests and whatever. But before I'm going to leave Skyhawk, let's check the War Council and assign our advice to some new missions, I guess. So, right, oh yes, the party. We had a party. Ha! A fine plan. Might I suggest that the apples be part of the hunt? A board choked on apples has sweeter flesh, or so I hear. Chancer. Well, I'm pretty sure it was a great party. Obtain amulet for Cole, Ambassador Montelier. It is rare to hear of those in Orlais treating spirits as anything other than beasts to kill, and rarer still for anyone to care enough for one to help them. I have given the amulet to your people freely, in hopes that the Inquisition will continue this open-minded approach. We wish you luck in healing the sky. Those rifts have damaged the fate even here in Rivain. Yours in peace, Lady Anna Maria of Dersmuth. Alright, this actually worked out well. And this is where I sent Liliana. Sister Liliana, our agents entered Lord Ansel's home, where they discovered several pieces of correspondence connecting Ansel to the Venatori. Worse, it seems Ansel did more than buy into their philosophy. He's been arranging to send volunteers to Red Lyrium mines. As they took these people from Rialto's poorer, more unfortunate residents, few noticed the disappearances. Our agents were prepared to confront Ansel with the evidence, but he failed to return. We have since learned that he hired a ship to Hercynia in the Free Marches. It seems unlikely that Ansel knew of our presence, but something spooked him. Mason. Liliana has written a note below. Have our agents track Lord Ansel to the Free Marches. His work for the Venatori must not continue. Let us pray the trial does not run cold. Liliana. An offer from the Crows. All right. Okay, there is some stuff that I can do here. I think this is the one for Sutherland. A hastily scribbled letter from the quartermaster. While I would never question the wisdom of the Inquisitor in such a contentious time, if we are to insist on relying on mercenaries acting in our names, I would ask that they represent us properly. We can't be seen to employ the poorly equipped in the Inquisition. More exactly, I cannot. I humbly request permission to outfit the crew, Sutherland leads, Sir Morris. Actually, I think that is a good idea. Let's do this. If they represent us, then they should reflect our influence. Alright. It would take little to have them look like the hidden arm they could be. He wishes them formidable. Make them formidable. Heavy armor. Yeah. I don't know if they're really that hidden. they don't really appear like some spies to me. And with Freya's bias towards soldiers, I guess she would prefer heavy armor as well. So let's do this.
Inquisitor.
And this is apparently something new for Varric. Hard and Hightown, Shovel and Skyhold. Copies of Hard and Hightown and Hard and Hightown 3, the Repungeoning, sit side by side on the table along with a note. Nightingale. Found several similarities to events in Varric's book, but all are slightly off. Dead magistrate was not in his home. Man found murdered in locked room was a comp, not magistrate. Executors did not send warning note directly to Donnan. Obviously, object of plot is Sword of Hesarion, not Penny Dreadful author. Close look at the rip-off book shows numerous grammatical and spelling errors that seemed random at first, but ciphers believe it might contain coded information. Killer and author are clearly linked. Either the murder investigation or the code might lead us to a target. Scrivener. Well, this is getting interesting. Someone got in and out of Skyhold without being seen. The cipher and the book might lead us to them. We should follow up on the murder investigation. The book is just a work of fiction. Yeah. I don't know. It seems very convoluted plan. But sure, let's trust.
Let's see what we have.
Liliana's instincts on that. So is there anything that we can do over here? Forging a way forward. Let's have a look at this. Inquisitor, with a treachery revealed, Marquise Effie Loche Buffon has fled into the mountains. Our initial efforts to pursue her have been hampered by both the terrain and the presence of demons in the area. While we have had difficulty making headway, the Grey Wardens have offered to assist. They seem to be the only force in the area capable of doing so. Regardless, I believe it is worth pursuing Marquise Buffon if we have the means to do so. Yours, Lieutenant Suzanne Cloche Sec. Our concern is the Marquise, not the demons. My people can find a way to her. Marquise Buffon may have enemies among the nobles in the area. Some of them may have information on safe passes through the mountains. The Grey Wardens will do better against demons than normal Inquisition soldiers. Let them fight through the mountains. So I'm not sure. This sounds like I have the choice between fighting the demons or pursuing the Marquis. Is this what this is about? I mean, we're talking about demons, not darkspawn, so I don't know if I really need the Grey Wardens for that. Yeah, sure. Let's try to get the Marquise and see what she's hiding.
At your service.
And that should be all of them. So let's leave for now. And yes, I got the amulet for Cole. But I'm not going to do this today because today I need to check out those quests at some point. But let's not waste too much time here. Let's head into the approach. And yeah, I think I'm just going to start at this camp and then I will try to get rid of all those quest markers. Let's travel here. Party. Somebody said I should consider a party made up of Dorian, Cole, and Iron Bull. So let's do this. Also a good opportunity to test my new champion skills, although I'm probably going to disable the Even Ground trial for this episode, simply because I want to focus more on my recap, and I think I can do this better if the fights are of a more, well, casual nature, I guess. So yeah, I'm going to put this back on later, but for now we'll just deal with the enemies in whatever level we encounter them. Okay, yeah, maybe let's check out what's over here. And yeah, I don't need that at the moment. And while I make my way through here, yeah, let's talk a bit about the game so far. Now, I won't be talking about the larger aspects of the game, like gameplay, because that's something that I will do at the end of the game. I'm also not really going to go into details about the characters, because I feel I should finish all of their companion arcs first before I talk about that. Also, maybe we can change our where is it? Western approach. There. Can change our quest. Maybe we can pick this one because yeah. Search for the mine. And I'm not going to talk about the characters because I feel I should really see how they develop over the course of the game before I actually make my verdict there. So I'm just going to talk a bit about the story and the mission so far, because usually in my final verdict I don't go that much into detail about, you know, single missions or single aspects of the story. So yeah, let's just, you know, start at the beginning. And I mean, the beginning of this game, they really threw you right into the thick of things, and it took about, I don't know, 10 or 15 minutes until you were basically established to be, you know, the savior of this game. And that was really, really fast. And somehow I feel that maybe they did this because they wanted to answer criticism that was brought up after Dragon Age 2. I think that a lot of people felt that your character in Dragon Age 2 wasn't, I don't know, important enough. I know that a lot of people actually enjoyed that aspect, that, you know, Hawk was just, you know, a normal person and not really special in that regard. But I think a lot of people also thought that a lot of the things you did in Dragon Age 2 were sort of trivial, and I kind of agree with that, especially in the first act. I mean, you spend most of the time running around, trying to collect money, doing more or less mundane tasks, so that you could go on a Deep Roads expedition that had the goal to earn more money. And that was sort of trivial. So I think in this game they wanted to establish you as, you know, a special, a savior sort of character right from the beginning, and they basically threw you right into this. Of course, at the same time, the intro mission sort of had to function as a tutorial, and it also had to set the stage for the whole game, introduce the characters, introduce the situation, tell you what was going on at the moment. And it was a little bit overwhelming, I felt. Okay, we have all the shots. And I feel that maybe they could have done a little bit of intro before the explosion, like, I don't know, your character arriving at the Conclave, just so that they could give you some information ahead of time. I mean, I understand why they wanted to start the game like they did, literally with a giant bang. But as a result of that, they had to give you a lot of information in a very short amount of time, and it was a little bit overwhelming. I have a feeling that chart is probably over there somehow. So let's try to find a way to get up there. And yeah, I'm going to pick up a lot of resources while I'm doing this. I mean, this is as good as time as any to do this. But in general, I think the first mission did a good job at, you know, establishing the situation. Once you got sorted through all the information that came down on you, and like I said, they wasted no time to make sure that everyone knew that you were basically the hero of this game. Oh, Dorian, this is for you. Oh, you're still climbing the ladder. All right. And I mean, once you were in Haven, there was a scene where you got out of your hut, and all the people were standing there waiting for you and calling you Herald of Andraste, and that was like 1 hour into the game. And at first it almost felt a little bit weird, because normally you are sort of used to having to work your way up in games like this. I mean, even in Origins, it wasn't really until after Ostagar that, you know, you got basically the role of savior, the one that had to fix everything now, because you and Alistair were the sole survivors. And after that, you were basically at a, you know, ground level, and you had to work your way up from there, because you literally had nothing except, you know, your lives, and now you had to start to work your way up to fight the Darkspawn. And in this game, you seemed to start at a relatively comfortable position. I mean, you were Herald of Andraste basically 1 hour into the game. You already had the Inquisition. I mean, it was smaller at that point, but you already had soldiers, you had a base, you had advisors. It seemed like a very comfortable position, and that was sort of unusual, and in the end it was of course a bit of a misdirect by the writers, and a pretty clever one, I think, because after a while, you know, when Corypheus came and destroyed basically everything you got, you realized they only gave you all that stuff in the beginning so that they could take it away from you again and then give you something even better. And I actually felt that was very cleverly done, that they, you know, first they pretended that you already have a pretty good position, and then you realize that they only did it so that you actually had something to lose in the assault at Haven. I think that's probably what they were going for with that. So yeah, I think it was strange that suddenly you were such an important person right from the get-go, but you understand it after in your heart shall burn. All right, let's quickly kill these demons. And yeah, I think that's oh, it's on cooldown. Okay, basically everything that I have to say about the intro. And I mean, once you got settled in at Haven, the story progressed sort of sluggish, but not too sluggish, I say. I mean, obviously, at that point, your main goal was to, you know, learn how to play the game, to get to know your characters and all of that stuff. So, for example, the whole plot point with Mother Giselle seemed relatively pointless in retrospect. I mean, you went to the Hinterlands, and basically all that did was that she told you to go to Val Royeaux, and actually right before going to Mother Giselle you basically said, well, I can't go to Val Royeaux and appeal to the Chantry because I don't have enough influence. And then you went to see Mother Giselle and she basically said, you know, you have to go to Val Royeaux, and that was kind of strange. I think the main reason for Mother Giselle was just that they had an excuse to send you to the Hinterlands. And of course then you had to, you know, spend some time doing random quests, collecting some influence, collecting some power, and then you could finally go to Val Royeaux. And this was obviously, you know, a method to make you, you know, explore the place a little bit and actually play the game such as it is. Oh, look at this. Discovered Gates of Toth.
No good. We'll have to find another way.
Yeah, there's a landmark here, but not within reach, apparently. Okay, so I can't actually go through here. Okay, then maybe let's at least try to find the shard that's somewhere around here. So yeah, the first time the story got some sort of progression was basically when you went to Val Royeaux. And this is another job for you, Dorian. There we go. Very nice. And in Val Royeaux you basically met the Templar leader and the Mage leader, which obviously was an important factor for your decision a bit later. I mean, I already spoke a bit about how I felt that the Templar mission and the Mage mission were sort of unevenly set up, because they kind of made the Templar quite a dick, the Templar leader, and the Mage leader was at least, you know, willing to talk to you. And I mean, apparently the Templar leader isn't actually important in the later quest, so I guess you don't actually work together with him. And I mean, there was one Templar that actually, you know, spoke up against him and said something like, yeah, but maybe, what if they're right, you know? But if I didn't fully notice that, to be honest. And I feel I could have done this a little bit better, maybe if, you know, the other Templar later came back to you and said something like, you know, we don't all agree with our leader, and why don't you come to, you know, our fortress, and maybe you can convince him to help you, or maybe we can work something out. I mean, this would only have been a very small scene, and I think it would have gone a long way to give you more of a reason to pursue the Templars instead of the mages. Also, it has been mentioned that the scene where you address the clerics originally was supposed to take place in a different place in the Grand Cathedral, and somebody actually posted a link to a picture of, you know, the layout, or the, you know, a render of the Grand Cathedral, and it looked a lot more epic than, you know, the little marketplace. I mean, I feel that Val Royeaux in this game, I think it serves its purpose, and its purpose for the most part seems to be to go there to shop and maybe meet some people occasionally. But for that particular scene, it would have been nice if it had been in a more grand setting, I guess. It almost seemed a little bit like some, I don't know, random market squabble, and not like something that was really important. Other than that, I think it's okay that Val Royeaux is sort of small, because even if they had put a really great city in its place, I mean, you would have to fill the city with something. Quests, content, whatever. And they didn't really do this, I guess, or they didn't really have the quests that would justify having such a large city there. So I'm not too sad about the fact that there was no big city instead of the little piece of Val Royeaux that we can actually visit, because if it just had been an empty city, it wouldn't really have mattered anyway. Okay, I see some enemies over there. That was a bit of an early taunt. And I think I know why. I think I have misordered my skills. I always had the charging bullet one, I'm pretty sure. Yeah. There we go, that's much better. And okay, let's maybe continue with the story. And after Val Royeaux, there was a bit of a time that basically was spent recruiting your companions. You picked up Sarah and Vivienne, and then you picked up Blackwall and the Iron Bull. And I mean, Dorian and Cole joined a little bit later. And in general, I feel that... Ooh, spider. In general, I feel that the recruiting missions were reasonably well done. I mean, for most of your companions, they gave you pretty good reasons why you would want to recruit them. I mean, there was obvious advantage of recruiting Vivienne, and I guess Iron Bull is useful, and the Grey Warden would be useful. I think the only ones that were a bit strange were Sarah, because she just came across as a little bit crazy at the beginning. And yeah, I guess Cole was a bit weird too, since nobody really knew what he was, but at the very least he has already shown to be useful at that point. But in general, I think they gave you good reasons to recruit the people that you could recruit, and didn't make it too awkward. Like, I don't know, I always felt that, you know, Stan and Zevran in Origins were kind of weird. And if it wasn't an RPG, and you know that in RPGs you always want to recruit everybody, you probably wouldn't do that, you know, recruit a murderer from a cage, or recruit the assassin that just tried to kill you. So it has been handled pretty well in this game. And I mean, obviously it wasn't really much of an issue in Dragon Age 2, because you weren't actually recruiting people, you were just, you know, making acquaintances at best. So, yeah, you did your recruiting for a while, and then you had to make your Mage Templar decision. I mean, I spoke very extensively about the decision and what I thought about it. Plus, why there is supposedly one of my quests around here, and I can't seem to find it. Yeah, I already spoke quite extensively about the whole Mage Templar decision, and as you know, I picked the mages. And then we got the mission in Redcliff Castle, which was basically the first real main mission. And it was a time travel mission, which I actually liked a lot, because time travel does give you the possibility to do some stuff that you normally couldn't do in a game. Specifically, kill off characters that you actually don't want to kill off. And I mean, they totally made use of that, of course, by having your companion and having Liliana die at the end of this mission. You know, just for the dramatic effect, because obviously they didn't really die, at least not in our reality. So I really enjoyed that they made use of the potential of the time travel. I guess I could have done even more so. I mean, I really would have liked to know more about what has happened to my other companions, for example, and how exactly, you know, the... Wow! Iron Bull, your horns must be really, really strong. Look at that. He's completely within the stone. This is interesting and strange. I hope you can get out of there again. Okay, you can. I think they could have used the time travel mechanic even more. I really would have liked to know more about what has happened in between, but I guess, considering the constraints of the mission, it was okay. In general, I really liked the aspect to show what would happen if you failed as Inquisitor, because it really gave your enemy and the whole story a new gravity, because it actually showed you, you know, if you don't succeed, this is what's going to happen, so you better succeed. And that was a very, very effective use of, you know, that future setting. Plus, I already mentioned that I liked, you know, Alexius as your enemy, because he was not your typical enemy, because he had motivations, because he seemed very human in his desire to, you know, save his son. And I think that was just generally well done. Alright, let's quickly kill these spiders, and maybe then we have a quick look around this cave, because there's one of our quests that takes place here. And then I will continue to talk about the game. Alright, there we go. A bunch of red mushroom. Note from a Templar, Benedict. Pull up stakes. All plans for the mine in the western approach are off. The Inquisition's on the move and headed your way. Dump all the bodies and relocate to Emprise de Lyon, Vernon. Huh. Oh, we have...
The song never sang here. For them. They were lucky.
Yeah, I guess I'm going to destroy this. I mean, it still gives me at least some approval, and I'm not really sure if I want to come back here just for that. So let's get rid of this. Wow, this is pretty indestructible. Then let's do it this way. Beric slightly approves. Okay, yeah, let's have a look around this cave before I continue talking. If there's anything interesting in here. Templar Commander Shield. Doesn't really look like there's more going on here. Oh, this is another Red Lyrium deposit. But there seem to be plenty of those, so... I mean, I could use some approval from Varric, because he didn't like how I sacrificed Hawk a few episodes ago. But I'm honestly not too worried about approval from Varric, so I think it's okay if he isn't with me in this case. Yeah, let me try to get up here. Why is this so difficult? I need to I need to get up here somehow. Anyway, while I try to parkour my way up here, let's maybe continue. So, after in Hushed Whispers, we had the next main mission, which was In Your Heart Shall Burn, and like I said, it was a bit of a misdirect on the sides of the writers to make you believe that you've already been settled in pretty well. I mean, they always kind of, you know, emphasis that you still had to gather more agents and get more influence, but you still seem to be in a fairly comfortable position. And then, you know, they sent you to close the rift, and obviously that didn't work out well. And basically, the game began at that point, which was a very, very clever way to do this. And it's probably one of the most memorable missions of this game so far. I mean, the main missions were all pretty memorable, I gotta say this, but In Your Heart Shall Burn was definitely one thing in it on its own, in terms of, you know, drama and excitement. Okay, let's see if we can't get through there somehow. I'm not even sure if this is in... Yeah, this is probably not in this cave. Okay. So, In Your Heart Shall Burn, you finally saw your enemy, which was Corypheus. I can understand that some people were a bit unhappy with that, considering that Corypheus was just a character from a DLC, and not everybody will have played that DLC. So, yeah, I can understand that they felt that something like the a villain of the next game shouldn't be, you know, hidden in a DLC. In my case, it didn't really matter since I did play the DLC, so I knew Corypheus, and it was, for me, it was actually a surprise, and I thought it was a nice twist to bring in an enemy that you already knew, because it gave a new level of threat to your enemy, because, I mean, you already killed him once, and it was damn difficult to kill him too, and suddenly he's back again. So I think it had a greater effect than if it had been just, you know, somebody completely new. But I can understand that some people would say they were unhappy since they didn't play the DLC and they didn't really know what was going on there at this point. But don't block mine, alright? But yeah, generally speaking, I think Corypheus, at least until now, seems to make, you know, a decent enemy. We haven't really seen much of him. And I've read many comments about that some people were actually disappointed and thought that Corypheus was a bit of a weak enemy or a generic enemy. But I mean, just from that one confrontation with him in Your Heart Shall Burn, I thought he came across as a pretty intimidating enemy. So I'm going to see how this will develop in the future, but for now, my only complaint about Corypheus is that you don't really see much of him. I mean, we had the mission in Your Heart Shall Burn, but after that, there isn't really much.
I can still work. I can. I don't need much food. The guard laughs, says he doesn't need me anymore. The blade comes down.
Oh, is this about these dead people? Well, that's really sad. Okay, yeah, let's stop for a moment to look at this cave, because there's a bunch of stuff, and yes, I'm picking up a good amount of these ghoul's beard, so maybe I can do some potion upgrading. Oh, and we have more red lyrium to destroy. 6 of 12, alright. A scrawled note. Lewis, S says get the Templars whatever they want, no questions asked. So stop asking. They want refugees and travelers. We get them. Marius. Alright. There's some just more resources, but yeah, I'm going to grab them anyway. Okay, I think I actually managed to pick up all the stuff that was lying around in this area. And yeah, I'm picking up something though. Okay, let me try to get up here.
That's a lot of carts. Why are they even out here?
I don't know. My guess is that they're trying to collect the red lyrium because they're putting it in chests again. And yeah, look at this guy. This is moderately creepy. Okay, I think I've cleaned out this cave. So yeah, I think I have spoken about In Your Heart Shall Burn, and I mean after that we spent a long time in Skyhold talking to companions, which was really really nice. But like I said, I will address the companions and their respective stories once I've actually finished them. So the next, you know, main mission after that was obviously the one that we have, you know, just finished, Realize the Abyss. And what I liked about this mission is how they basically played with your biases and used your biases against you. I mean, first of all, they basically put up the Grey Wardens as your enemy, at least, you know, sort of your enemy. And I think that simply because you played a Grey Warden in Origins, that probably a lot of people are sort of biased in that regard. At least I was. Maybe not everyone, but I was. And it's not easy to overcome that bias and, you know, accept the fact that, you know, they're wrong and they need to be stopped. And of course we had the great decision at the end of the mission, where again they used your biases against you because you had to choose between your character and some other character, which could either be Stroud or Alistair or Loghain, I guess. And of course I think from a biased position you would always sort of tend to favor your own character, especially if the alternative is somebody like Stroud, who is, well, yeah, I guess a decent guy with a sexy voice, but that's about it. So that's why I decided to roleplay that decision and not let my personal bias decide it. I mean, I could have taken the easy way and just sacrificed Stroud, but I think the writers kind of wanted to guilt trip you in a way, because if you did that, you probably would ask yourself all this time, did I actually make this decision because I had good reasons, or did I just save Hawk because I liked her better? And I know that I probably would have asked this question to myself if I had chosen to save Hawk over Stroud. I probably would have felt kind of guilty about letting my personal bias influence my decision. So I thought it was actually a clever idea to give you that decision. Now, some people have said that before I actually went to that mission, or before I actually made that decision, that my decision would be easier because of my world state, because I had Stroud. I don't think this was the case. As a matter of fact, if I think about having Alistair instead of Stroud in this mission, ironically, it would have made things easier for me, because I could never, ever kill Alistair. So, my decision would have been ultimately the same. I would still have sacrificed Hawk. But in that case, my personal bias would actually have aligned with my roleplay decision. And, you know, because Stroud kind of was the easy way out, it was hard not to take that easy way and to sacrifice Hawk regardless. So if I had to choose between Alistair and Hawk, It would still have been painful, but there wouldn't have been an easy way. And it wouldn't have been, you know, like I've been... It wouldn't have been like I had to force myself to not take the easy way. And by that, it would have been sort of, you know, easier for me to make this decision, because I totally would have saved Alistair, no matter what. So, yeah, that's why I would say the decision wasn't easy for me. I didn't want to make it easy. Sacrificing Stroud seemed just like, you know, a very lazy way to do it. So I picked Juno to die, and I can honestly say that I'm okay with the decision. You know, thinking back a few days later now, I think it was a good decision. Simply because it is a better end for her story than just, I don't know, grow old and settle down, because Juno is just not the type, you know. She's definitely, you know, a live fast, die young type. I can't honestly picture her growing old and becoming, I don't know, settling down, having a family, whatever. I can imagine that for... I mean, Skadi sort of did do this, right? She did marry, and she did become queen, although apparently she's still out there somehow having adventures. I can also totally see this for Freya, as somebody who would at some point say, okay, it's fine, I had my adventures, but now it's time to settle down and, you know, take it a bit slower. But Juno, I don't know, I can't see it for her. So I think this was the best end that her story could have. And I honestly think that Juno wouldn't regret it either, because... I mean, despite all the crap that happened to her in her life, I mean, she had a lot of crap happening to her. I honestly think that if Juno would look back at her life, she would say that, you know, I had a good life, and I don't regret a thing. And in that regard, I think it was just a good time for her to you know, to end it. And yeah, she was just, you know, this positive character. And you know the there is the saying, if life gives you lemons, make lemonade. And that was basically, you know, Juno Hawke in a nutshell. So I think she can look back at her life and say, I had a good life despite all of what that has happened. And now I can have a good death and make it count. So yeah, I think it's okay. I think it's fine that we left her behind and gave her story a worthy ending and not just let her walk away and grow old. So yeah, let's see. Yeah, we did manage to pick up all the stuff in this area. Didn't really manage much though, because yeah, talking while doing quests is not the easiest. But I think I'm actually going to end the episode here. It is long enough, and I have looked back at all the major missions we have done so far and shared my thoughts on them. And yeah, just as a general verdict so far, yes, I do really like the game. I think the stories seem a lot more meaningful to me than they did in Dragon Age 2, where, you know, a lot of stuff, like I said, was sort of trivial. And I like that in regards to your companions, they kind of went a middle way between the last two games. On the one hand, you have all those cutscenes with your companions like you had in Dragon Age 2, but you can also talk to them, and I really like the fact that you can just talk to them and they have always something to say. So I'm really looking forward to do this more. Speaking of which, I'm actually going to do some of the companion missions soon. I think what I'm going to do now, I will end this episode because I don't think I have that much more to say. And I will probably do some off-camera work, mainly picking up those landmarks and, yeah, all these rather menial side quests. And I think in the next episode I want to finish this place over here, and then we can go back to Skyhold, and then I actually want to start one or maybe two of the companion missions. So yeah, I hope you enjoyed hearing me ramble about the game so far, but like I said, I really liked it so far. I thought that the main missions were all very unique and very well thought out. I didn't really get much stuff done here, but at least a little bit. And yeah, there's so many hyenas here. It's ridiculous. It's really ridiculous. But yeah, I'm going to end the episode here. And in the next episode, I will try to finish the Western Approach completely. And then it's time to head back to Skyhold. And I will try to use some of my champion skills in the next episode. I didn't really need it in this episode because, you know, I wanted the my enemies to be a bit casual. So yeah, anyway, thank you for watching. I hope you enjoyed, and see you again next time.